Hey guys, this is Coach Keita Bussey with 180 Firearms Training, Sam Callahan. And today we've got Josh Freilich on as a guest. Welcome to the 180 Firearms Training Podcast. All right, Josh, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself once again? This is your second time on.
Yeah, absolutely. Josh Freilich. And I like to pull triggers. And so pretty much any of the activities that involve pulling triggers, whether it's competition, just blanking with my buddies or chasing critters anywhere out in the timber, those are things that I like to do. And I really like to share all of that with the world to, I guess, grow it, if you will. A lot of the things we're doing that I'm doing are, I would call, almost dying arts or starting to become taboo. And so it's like, well, they are going to continue to go that direction if somebody doesn't tell the rest of the world about how cool these activities are. And so I've got a mission to share shooting sports with the world. And that's what I work really hard on a daily basis.
And now you've got your range built at your place.
Yep.
You want to talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, F5 range is one of the ways that we share the shooting sports, right, with the world is we have folks out to our facility. And I built a private gun range out here where we host public events and a lot of private events for different companies that want to do like media capture and things like that. We do probably 20 to 25 training classes out here a year. Lots of them are not even announced. They're just a few folks coming out, 5-6 folks wanting to get together and learn some things. And then we do some bigger events as well that we're out talking about and bringing folks in and having brand partners align with us so that we can do giveaways and like all kinds of crazy stuff. We try to make it a big deal. And then this last year, we built our guest lodge. So we built a guest lodge, sleeps like 16. And we have a private chef come in and cook cool dinners for the group that's staying here and do some live music at night, sitting around the fire. And like we've kind of pulled out all the stops to create this white collar destination that you can come and just get to Minneapolis and we'll pick you up at the airport. We'll feed you. We've got ammo here. We've got a range. We've got lodging. Like we just give you something maybe a little different up here at F5.
So tell us about your white collar hunting experience.
I'll tell you what that means. So up here, there's a lot of places you can go and hunt, right? They have gigantic animals. For like $5,000, you can go somewhere and shoot some monster buck or, whatever. You can go do that. And we don't have that. We're limited to the animals that we have around here. But what we have is opportunities to get new people into the space in a way they're comfortable with. Right. And so we have lots of deer. I was out in one of the blinds tonight. I saw 4 deer. Like we could shoot deer. Like that's not a problem. And so when I have folks that want to learn more about hunting, I call it white collar because you need a white collar budget in order to come participate. We put them up at my guest lodge. We have fine meals cooked for them. Like I cater the experience based on the budget. We give them really cool experiences and show folks that maybe didn't grow up in the space how to take, a bullet and a rifle and turn it into food. And we walk through that whole process in a very customer-centric way so that they could go out and do that on their own perhaps in the future or come back here and share that with somebody else in their family that hasn't experienced it, right? And so I only do a couple of those a year. We love to hunt. My kids are hunting, my family's hunting. I have some business partners that'll come out and hunt. And with animals, it's one of the reasons training's great, because like I can train somebody again tomorrow, but like if I shoot a bunch of deer tonight, like can't necessarily shoot a bunch more tomorrow on the same property. And so it's one of those things that doesn't scale, right? But we love to do it. Again, we love to share these activities with folks that haven't already participated in them somewhere else. Mm-hmm. And give them a cool experience.
That's awesome.
So, Do you have an idea of where the deer bed on your, it's your property, so I'm guessing you probably have an idea of where they bed and where to look?
Yeah, we know this. We know this property really well. I've only got a couple hundred acres, which from a hunting perspective is not a lot. But we are surrounded by about 4,000 acres of state forest and protected wildlife management area and all of that. And I know that land inside out, like it's mine. Yep. I mean, we trap it. And so I know where all the game trails are. I know where all of the bedding thickets are. Like I know where all of the animals go and live. And so when it comes to hunting the animals that live here, it's not hard because I live here too. And I run the same trails they do. I know the same areas they do. And so, yeah, it's taken me a few years to really get to know it. But I know the this 4,000 acres or so really well.
Love that.
Go ahead.
Yeah, one of the big things I love that I've been seeing is you are obviously an elite level shooter, and you're bringing now hunting and everything back into the mix, and you're not just hammering competitions, you're out there shooting. And I just said this comment to my wife the other day, I don't think enough people see where their food comes from, and even shooters, they don't see mm-hmm. where their food comes from enough. And I was lucky enough to grow up shooting birds. It was literally part of like our diet. I didn't realize how, I don't want to say poor, how redneck we grew up until I realized, yeah, that we ate pheasant as like Thanksgiving, you know? And I backed my way into competition that way. So I was lucky to see it from the, oh, this is how you shoot birds, but there's only a 2 to 3 month window to shoot them. So we backed into sporting clays, and then I found competition. And it's cool to see it from the other way. It's cool to see it from you were a national level shooter and you just now took it and know I'm going to share the art of pulling triggers in general with everybody. I like that. I really like that.
Yeah. That's part of the mission, right? Is like, we've got all these little separate siloed communities and it drives me nuts.
Yes.
Tactical shooters and cop shooters and hunters. And you got all these different groups that, you know, they're pointing fingers and they're, you know, arguing online and like, they don't get along. I'm like, what are you doing? Like,
we're all the same people.
Yeah, we're all good
people. Yeah, I came from sporting clays. My sister shoots elite level sporting clays. She's a national level shooter. I don't see her. We don't see each other. Like, why? That's so crazy. We don't go to the same events. We don't go to the same places. It's so weird to me. I love that. I wish more of these guys, the hunters talk to the shooters, the shooters talk to everybody. That's cool to hear.
There is a lot of division, yeah.
Yeah, no doubt.
So you only live maybe an hour and a half from me. And Sam, the deer that you have, I mean, they're pretty big for North America, but compared to what we have, they are enormous where we live.
Mm-hmm.
Like you go down to Texas and we call them forest rats because they're going under the fences where here they're jumping over the fences. Yep. They're like little
horses. The deer we have around here, you hit with your car more than you hit with bullets. They're rats on stilts. That's all they are. They're bullshit around here. I have friends who travel out to you guys to go hunt and stuff, and it blows my mind when I see what you guys actually have out there. Not just like the racks and the deers, but the size of those things, man.
Yeah.
Like some meaty deer.
They're big. There's a lot of meat there for sure.
Yeah.
And they do typically take the same trails, so you can kind of figure out where they're going to be. But mm-hmm. they also know when it's hunting season.
Yeah, for sure. They are not dumb. There's a reason the big ones got big. And, you know, so they have like, they've got plans. But then, you know, breeding season comes in and they act stupid. And so you just never know what you're going to walk out to. And that's why it's still hunting. I mean, you know, we've got all these beautiful blinds that are set up that keep you out of the elements. And we got little heaters in them and they're spray foamed insulated. Like, luxury office chairs in them, you know, like we got all of that stuff.
That's awesome.
And half the time I end up sneaking out to some corner of the woods sitting on the edge of the swamp because that's where the big deer want to be anyway. So I'm like, all right, still hunting.
Well, I know you're a competition shooter of a lot of experience. Do you find a lot of crossover with that, like I got one shot at this deer, I got one shot at this day, I got one shot at this stage at competition? Is that like something that rings a bell in your mind, or is that just totally different worlds?
It's similar in being able to manage emotion and being able to maybe manage that energy level when it's time to execute, time to make a good shot.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd say I'm faster on the gun as a hunter than anyone that I hunt with, right? Like, so, you know, and I can make a good shot right now, even if I'm not ready for it. And so usually if I'm hunting birds, I'm batting cleanup. I let everybody else take a swing and then I'll shoot. And then, you know, if I'm shooting a whitetail or something like that, it's like, man, if I get a good look at it, I can usually put it down. You know, you get that comfort level with the gun. It's like, I know how to mount this gun, get on the trigger fast, optics in the window, reticle's right where it's supposed to be, and I'm ready to shoot. So, you know, there are not too many missed opportunities when you get any kind of an opportunity on an animal, if you're real comfortable because of shooting a bunch of competition.
So stress is just something you're comfortable with. So coming from your backgrounds and coming from shooting competitions, you don't really, I mean, people call it buck fever. I know you're probably excited when you see it, but
oh, yeah.
it's not something that you're like, oh no, I don't know, I've never been here before. You're like, all right, I've felt this before.
I can put this No, I watched my daughter kill her first deer 2 days ago.
That's awesome, man.
And cool.
She's this bubbly, shaky mess. Yeah. I was like,
been there.
No big deal, you know. And I remember that energy.
Yeah,
and, it's mostly not here anymore.
Very cool.
I'd love to get a little piece of that back, though. That looks fun.
Yeah, that's cool to hear, though, man. It's cool to hear you sharing it with your daughter. That's awesome. I grew up as a little kid hunting, and it's something I'll never forget. So that's cool.
So with your group that you bring out, let's say somebody gets a deer, do you talk them through like hanging it, gutting it, skinning it, all of that, or do you have them send it somewhere to have that done, to have it processed?
It leaves in packages. Yeah, we absolutely butcher everything here. I've got a building on site. It's called the Chop Shop. It's got, you know, everything about it is a big butcher shop, and mm-hmm. got, you know, hydraulic hoists and like all of this stuff. So we get the deer in the back of the Ranger or the UTV, back it right up into the chop shop, put it on the hoist, skin it out, clean it up, and package it up, grind it up. You know, if somebody wants something special, I don't do all the brats and all of that special stuff here. So we'll send them with we can send that off. But for the most part, if we shoot a deer here, it doesn't leave the property until it's ready to, you know, go in the freezer.
Awesome.
And you do a lot of trapping as well. I saw you posted a video getting all your traps out. What do you trap?
Everything. If it lives here, we trap it. Our favorite things to chase are, I chase beavers. So we've got 30
pounds.
Yeah, they're big. They're 40, 50, 60 pounds. And it's good eating, actually. It's good food. So we chase a bunch of those. Raccoon, we chase a bunch of them. And then I chase otter, fisher, bobcat, and some coyotes. That's the majority of what we'll catch out here. We spend the winter. I spend like 2 weeks in late October, early November trapping. And then mid-winter, when it's just brutally cold out, I run about 100 set trap line on my snowmobile for a few weeks. Because all the predators, that's when I go after them, because they're looking for any kind of a meal they can find, and they're really easy to trap. And then the spring again, we get into the swamps and go after otter and beaver and stuff. Beaver in the spring. Otter's not a season at that point.
You do any bear hunting?
Yeah, that's my favorite. I went to Idaho this spring, got a pretty little cinnamon bear, brown bear. It's a black bear, but it was brown in color. And then we hunt here, but I wasn't able to take a deer or a bear this year at home. I just didn't get the opportunity. They were coming at night, and obviously you can't hunt them at night, and they were smart. So there's a reason. Mm-hmm. Some of these critters, they know what you're doing.
Peter, you should have them out to Double Eagle then, because I've literally had to stop lessons because a black bear walked through the pit and up and over the next bay. Are you kidding? Are you watching?
That's crazy.
Yeah, we got to have them out.
We had to scare a deer away so we wouldn't accidentally shoot it. It was standing right next to the 200-yard gong. So I had my student hit the gong to scare him away, and it worked.
Yeah, they're ridiculous out there. We got to have you out there. We need somebody to help me thin the herds out there.
Yeah, it sounds delicious.
So have you seen the timber wolves in your area?
Yeah, we catch them, you know, like accidentally, and then I got to let them go. Like you get them on a catch pole, like, you know how they catch like a stray dog,
yeah,
yeah,
and let them off the trap and let them go. And They're a crazy animal. We got a whole bunch of them.
That's gonna be a wild experience. Yeah.
I got a nice surprise from one of those when I was taking out my trash one day. His head was like up to here. That thing was huge.
Yeah. Yeah. They're a crazy critter. They kill things with their face like every day.
Yeah. It's a wild animal. Things with their face.
Yeah. That's you know, crazy. Coming to the wolf.
But so, wow, that's awesome though. Sam, you wanted to get into some red dot questions. You had some specific ones in mind.
Yeah, so I always notice just kind of like the trends of things. And I've noticed you've kind of, you've been on the forefront of, we'll call it open at first, right? Like you were always shoot open back when I was shooting three gun and not much USPSA. And then when everybody's now always shooting open and three gun, you're doing something else, and then you're doing something else and you're doing something else. And I'm just, I always have noticed that. And I, something specific I noticed was you were on a slide ride optic on most of your guns, right? Yep. And do you find a huge advantage or disadvantage to that? Like, I just was curious as to why you had that choice.
Got it. Yeah. So it's a disadvantage from a shooting perspective. Very, very slight, but it's there. If I have a frame-mounted optic that isn't reciprocating with the slide, it is moving less. There's less mass on that slide creating... If you get a dot on the back of that slide and then it reciprocates, it's going to create a little bit more muzzle flip.
Just so you definitely feel that. You definitely can. It's not like, oh, I don't care. You definitely feel that.
Yeah, I absolutely. I can still. Okay, so let me put it this way. So I can still shoot it just as fast when I'm training, but I have to do a lot more work to do that.
Okay.
Right? So like if I'm shooting a three-port frame-mounted open gun, like I don't have to have a good grip. I can shoot that thing fast and be sloppy.
Okay.
If I'm running a slide ride with a red dot on it, which I do, I've got to have a great grip on that gun. I've got to be holding it just right. Everything's got to be dialed in order to really run it hard. But the major advantage that it gives me in multi-gun is I can run my hooded holsters. And so when I'm shooting prone with a rifle or something like that, or running real hard with a shotgun, and I don't want to have to worry about that race gun flying out and getting the DQ and going home after prep for a match and travel and all of those things. And so for me, I'm going, okay, I never, ever have to worry about my gun flying out. It's worth having work a little hard to get that grip out and be able to shoot it well. And so it's a give and take for sure. There's positives and negatives. But I think overall, if you train with it constantly, you don't give up a whole lot because you don't know anything about getting lazy on the gun because you've always had the grip like that, right? Just like folks that are shooting 40s and stuff like that for limited, it's like they don't get a break from having to grip that gun. No. You just do it because you know you have to.
Yep.
You know, if they shot 9 for a month or two and went back to their 40, they wouldn't shoot it the same, right? It'd take a minute to reestablish that. Those good habits. It's the same for me when I'm messing around with different open guns and slide rides and stuff.
And that takes a toll on your body over time too. Have you had any the shooter's elbow? Anything like that?
For sure. Yep, absolutely. I think part of that, usually it happens in the spring, especially now that I'm starting to take a little bit of an off season. When I get back into it and I start messing with my dry fire and I start messing with all of that stuff, I probably grip harder in dry fire than you need to, but like everything there is about details. And so I'm going, okay, well, I want to take everything to the extreme, meaning like if I'm transitioning to a target, I want it to be perfect to the center of that target. Like everything's the extreme, grip that thing like crazy, all of that in dry fire. And when I'm really ramping up and my hands aren't used to it, my tendons aren't used to it, have to ease into that. And I guess that doesn't mean I do less reps, but it means that I switch guns. So I'll run like pistol on like Monday, Thursday, once over the weekend, run shotgun and or rifle the other days. I'm not overdoing one muscle group by, you know, running one gun constantly. That's how I've figured out a way around getting tennis elbow and all this junk that comes from overtraining.
So you don't do anything to treat it. You just mix up what you're working on. So it's not constantly stressing the same joint.
No, I treat it to, so when I'm really ramping up, I basically just keep a dish of rice, uncooked rice.
Nice.
Extend it to work the opposite end of those muscles. Instead of squeezing, working on the extension. And that's a big part of my ramp up period for the year too, is just getting all my muscles and hands and everything used to all that again.
So I just take a hair tie and go like this.
I use the rice analogy and then I tell everybody to get the bands, but that's somebody who's definitely an ex fighter who actually knows that trick, right?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
And it works so many more angles if you use the rice. It works everything. It's just better, but then you have a big bucket of rice sitting around.
Yeah. It's pretty, it feels like a waste when there's a giant bucket of rice that you're not going to eat when you're done. It does a nice job.
Hey, you're making money with those hands.
Yep. Important.
So are you teaching any Red Dot specific classes, any specific curriculum for that? Or just when people come to you, you work on whatever they need?
Yeah. So no, not necessarily. I mean, most of what we do is platform specific, not sighting system specific, meaning, you know, like this coming year, I've got a modern carbine event, which is AR focused. It's just AR-15, all the skills necessary to run an AR-15 close and far away with skill. We've got an erasing AKs event. Most of the folks in the AK community, we talk about those different silos, right? And folks, that is its own silo, is this AK culture, this AK group. And they could use a hand learning how to shoot our matches. And so when there's all these AK matches, having that racing AKs event really does help those folks compete at a higher level when they come out. The basics and fundamentals of running a carbine well in comp, and then also AK manipulations. That we do a competition PCC event, and then we'll do a pistol event this year, and either a three gun, I'm not sure yet on that, or probably a hunting rifle season prep. All these guys spend $5,000 on a rifle, $3,000 on the optics, $10,000 on tags, and get ready to go on their trip. And then they shoot like 4 rounds at the indoor range, and then they wonder why they missed their goat or whatever they were going out to hunt. It's like, well, if you spent $1,000 on training and really understood how to build good positions and pull that trigger straight back and had all the real data and all that stuff for your scope, and you'd hit that thing. And so, basically, it's platform specific, and then when we're doing that, we certainly work through some sighting system skills, whether that's scope or red dot, or depending on the event, racing AK's event, for instance. I'll have Kyle Litzy out here, and he'll be co-instructing with me, and he shoots irons really, really well on his AK. So we'll be talking through some different sighting techniques as it relates to irons versus optics when you hear.
Cool.
So a lot of people are switching now from production to carry optics, and they're working with the dot for the first time. And I'm getting a lot of questions from the people who are just switching, just basic things like, how do I accept the wiggle? Because they're used to the iron sights. Now they're getting all this feedback and they just don't even know how to handle it. What advice would you have for someone going through the dot wiggle?
Yeah. I mean, the way that I put it, and I didn't make this up, I don't know if it was Max or JJ or some, one of those dudes was just talking about painting with the dot, right? And I heard that and I was like, that makes sense. I'm stealing that. I'm going to use it, but I'll give whoever the heck it was some credit. Like, when I'm shooting with a dot, like, that dot's never still. And if it is still, I'm shooting way too slow. I literally will paint with the dot. And so I bring it up on target, swipe it over when it's in the acceptable zone. I pull that trigger. And then the moment that paintbrush or that dot comes back down into that acceptable sight range, again, I'll pull that trigger again. And so it's more like I try to think about smooth strokes on like a paintbrush, if you were painting everything, versus like, I need to hit there. I need to hit there. It's like, no, I need to time that dot movement so that I'm pulling the trigger right when that's going to be in the acceptable sight picture zone, so I get those hits. And so just, it's a comfort thing for sure, getting used to you know, painting with a dot versus like, I need to put it right in the perfect spot, hold it there, and then shoot. But no, Well, you don't have to do that at all.
with the plate rack, you know, the plates are so close together, it's a narrow transition. You can start to pick up the next plate from within the window, where normally you wouldn't do that, you know, on a transition of a wider transition. But when you're shooting a plate rack, it just looks like you're drawing a line, and then the trigger goes off whenever it hits, you know, it's on the middle. Yep. The gun never stops moving when you're shooting a plate rack.
Yep. And I'll use that plate rack example as well when I'm talking about getting folks to pull that trigger press when it's back in the acceptable sight picture zone, because you can't stop recoil. None of us can. It's impossible. The gun will recoil. And so what we do is we steer the gun, right? And so if I'm shooting that plate rack, basically, you know, little M's as I go across that thing, the moment it comes back down and it's on the plate, I can shoot. And then it's immediately going to jump back up, and all I have to do is steer that into the next plate in order to get that next shot. And so, yes, you see way more when you're shooting the dot you would ever see shooting irons. And it does confuse some folks at first. And then they want to stare at the dot. Like, don't look at the dot. And they're like, what do you mean don't look at the dot? The dot's right there. It's like, I understand it's right there. Look at the target, right? And when the dot gets over the target, you can shoot. And like, if you had that front sight focus for a long, long time, and that was your focus on those precise shots, it can be a challenge. The moment you notice your eye starting to change focus between target and the dot is the moment you know you're doing it wrong. Your eyes shouldn't be changing focus off of the targets at all while you're shooting those dots, and that will help. So that's usually the thing. I'm like, I can't see where you're focusing, but if it feels to me like you don't know where to look, just based on the cadence that you're shooting these targets, it's like, are you focusing back on the dot? It's like, yeah, I'm staring right at it. It's like, oh, okay, that's not what we're doing here.
So you ever tape dots as a training tool, or do you just try to get your head right?
I haven't. I shot dots a long time before I ever even heard of that technique. That technique makes sense. And, you know, like, even when I've used that technique even before that was their technique without knowing it. In three gun, they often give us these little skinny ports to shoot rifles through, right?
Yeah.
And so you shoot that through some skinny port that, fastest way to do it oftentimes is my offset dot, and the offset dot's occluded, but my left eye can see around the barricade.
Makes a lot of sense.
So I'm shooting an occluded dot by looking straight at the target, even though my primary eye and the dot behind the wall. So I've used that technique a lot shooting rifle on three gun stages, and so when I started to see some of that occluded dot stuff, I was like, that makes a lot of sense. I never really thought of it, but it does make a lot of sense.
I do a lot of research on vision and vision training and how to apply it to shooting, taking a lot of things from other sports where they have to aim and applying it to shooting. Okay. And one interesting thing is your accommodation muscles have to work a lot harder at close distance, but at a far distance, then you can relax more and it's easier. So for those people who are really having trouble with their focus constantly switching and accommodating back and forth, just back them up to like 20 yards, and then they'll have an easier time keeping the focus on the target, then slowly, little by little, move them closer to the target.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, for sure, because it'd be way more of an extreme, right?
Because what?
Be way more of an extreme between the target and your dot. And so you would notice if you were starting to switch focus versus if you're 3 yards away looking at paper, you know, up on the dot, it'd be harder for the shooter to realize what they're doing wrong too.
Yeah, it seems obvious when you say it like that, but I feel like people in dry fire don't realize they're standing 5 feet from the wall and they're looking at a scaled target and they're like, why can't I get this? And I'm like, dude, just take a big target, put it on the backside of your garage and just work on that. Like, relax, man, relax.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah,
so that worked for one of my students over the weekend, who was really having trouble with eyes switching back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, and he just couldn't keep that focus on the target. And I could see his accommodation muscles going just constantly, and he couldn't hit anything, getting so frustrated. Then we backed him up to 20 yards, and he was fine.
Great.
And this was with the dot occlusion.
Okay. Very cool.
That worked out really well. It was interesting. He was kind of my guinea pig.
Yep. Well,
it was Blake.
I know exactly who you're talking about.
The fun part about training, folks, too, is we learn a lot. Like when you, I never learned so much about shooting.
Right.
Until I started actually coaching, because I just shoot. When I go train, I don't think about the whys behind it. I don't really think, like, I'm either doing it right or I'm not. Like the first probably 4 or 5 years, I shot a lot. And then once you start teaching people, it's like, well, you know, the first question I would ask if somebody told me this is why? Like, what do you mean? Mm-hmm. Like, why should I do it that way? They start to think about it and give it, you know, do a little research on it. It's like, man, I learned a ton just by knowing I've got to teach some people in 2 weeks on some topic.
Yeah.
Like, all right, I know how things work because I do it a certain way. Like, why do I do them that way? And you start to, you know, uncover some of the background info that it makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, I agree. It's one of the, everybody, it's the obvious you learn through teaching kind of thing. But when I tell somebody, hey, you have to do it like this, and they turn and they go, why? And I go, I've never been presented with that. It worked. That's why. And then you go, huh? And you start thinking about it. It's like, yeah, actually, you don't realize it as a novice. You just helped me learn myself better, which is cool. And then I can pass it along. So I understand that. It's very cool to see that, like, learning through teaching sensation. It's very fun. And it's just, I mean, I like making people shoot better, so it feels good.
Yep.
For me, I feel like a lot of what I do goes the other way, because I'm taking proven research and then applying it to shooting. So I'm almost starting with the why, mm-hmm. and then trying to find a way to apply it, if it applies.
Got it. That's interesting too.
So it's kind of backwards for me.
Yeah, I don't ever do that. That would be interesting to try different concepts. I bet you find some aha moments by doing it that way.
Right. Yeah, or it's just me saying, well, why are people doing it this way? It seems to be working. And then I start researching. I'm just a big nerd.
Helps though. I mean, I tell everybody all the time I'm a gun nerd. That's why I care about my grip and my dot and all this stuff. It's just I'm a gun nerd.
That's fair. Yeah, you too.
So what other tips and tricks do you have for people who are just switching to a dot for the first time?
Turn it down. You know, like everybody wants to turn that thing on, crank it all the way up. I'm like, man, you want to stop looking at that thing, turn it down a little bit, right? So that you can actually see the target behind it. And so really, I probably turn it down to the point they're uncomfortable with. They're like, well, I can barely see it. It's like, perfect. Got it. Like, you need to shoot with that way forever? No, you figure out whatever you're comfortable with later.
Right.
But from the exercise where I'm trying to get you to already focus the whole time, like if that thing's starburst and filling up half of the window, it's like pretty hard to look at that target while you're putting that over the top of it. And so I just turn it down. Get them to look at the actual target itself, spend as much time with that. And then I work a lot on presenting the gun, because the biggest challenge I see with an early red dot shooter is they don't know how to find it on a pistol. They're messing around with their grip. And then when they do shoot, the grip's all wonky because they've just found the dots. They shoot no matter how their grip is angled and all that stuff. So it's like, all right. Right out of the holster, let's establish a good grip. And it's the grip from here. Like, let's find the dot. Yep, you found the dot. What's your grip feel like? Okay, that's your grip. Now, let's establish our grip on the gun in the holster that way, or darn near it, so that we don't have to reestablish it on the way up, because you want to find that dot again, right? Immediately when you present. So then we work through presenting the gun, grip, and making sure that that piece is consistent, because if that piece is consistent, you're fighting it a lot less. So presenting the gun is something we spend a bunch of time on. And that's the same with any carbine or shotgun. It's like, it's a little easier, right? Because you have an extra point of contact, get a cheap weld, all that stuff. But it's like, even then, if you have a garbage, you know, if you don't present the gun right, and you don't get a good consistent cheap weld in the same spot, you're still having the delay to that first shot. It's just not as extreme. Mm-hmm. It's very obvious on a pistol when someone is doing the whole risk thing, but it's relevant on all the platforms. And so when somebody's not really used to it, the concept, turn it down a little bit, work on presenting the gun, make sure that all of those foundational fundamentals are there. And then it'll be easier for you to get on target. And when you get there, you won't have some wonky grip you got to deal with, because you've established a grip based on being able to present the gun well with it. You can shoot. And so spending a bunch of time there too.
So something else interesting I've been doing is taking a target. And if you picture your brown target with a white no shoot in front of it, cut out where the white no shoot is and take it away, so all you have is the remaining brown, and it really messes with you. And it turns out we're actually using the no shoot as a guide for where to shoot. Do you find that your eye just goes straight to the spot as though the no shoot isn't even there? Or do you find that you're using the no shoot as a guide, or do you even know what's happening in your head when you do it?
Good question. I'd say the only reference that I would have on that is like a Shannon Smith 1/3 target, right? You go shoot one of his matches and he's cut those darn targets in half, and they're way harder to shoot than they would be if it had a no shoot on it. Mm-hmm. Right. He's got swingers that are 1/3 of the target. Like, oh man, those are brutal. I'd say, yeah, I'm sure that I use the no shoot visually as a reference to figure out where to aim on that thing, because I shoot a target that's half covered with a no-shoot way faster than one of Shannon's half targets, that's for sure. So I'm sure my eyes use that as some kind of a reference.
Yeah, what's interesting is I'll have people shoot it normally like a match, then I'll take away the no-shoot and it's just all cut out, and they shoot it again and they get way slower. Then put it back on, and all of a sudden they're smoking their initial time because it seems so much easier, and they're shooting the exact same thing they were before.
Isn't this from your kit?
Yeah,
that's something like this. Where you're literally just shooting what is there.
Like if the other half of it was a no shoot,
yeah,
and then you take away the no shoot, then put it back on, it really just messes with your head. But you do get faster. It's like you trick yourself into shooting faster and more accurately.
It's going back to the why thing. You were just shooting and you weren't asking why, and then all of a sudden you have to figure out, oh, what the hell am I looking at? And then you pick something to look at, and then you go back to it. And it's nice. That addition by subtraction training is something that always, it speaks to my brain anyway.
Yeah, it's surprising how frustrating it is, and the targets just blend in with the background, and it's so hard to find.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I suppose even just that flash of white helps you pick it up so much quicker to use it as a reference.
I'll tell you, everybody's still complaining about the Area 8 like 2-3 years ago where they painted all the steel brown. Everybody's still complaining about that. So there's something to that. There definitely is.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, another interesting thing about the eye is your eye doesn't want to focus on what you're looking at directly. So that means as you're transitioning to your target, you basically have a soft focus, and then your brain is telling your eye, focus on this one spot. So do you find that you really narrow your vision down to one little spot on a target when you're shooting at it?
It depends on the difficulty level for sure. But yeah, on a harder target, I try to pick a more drastic center point or focus point on the closer stuff where the acceptable sight picture is pretty big. I'm just, if it's in the window, I'm just hammering. And so, for sure. And those are probably the more difficult visual cues that I have is, let's say you've got 2 or 3 fast, close targets, followed by one precise target at the back of the bay. You gotta be really good trigger discipline, really good visual discipline. And then maybe you're transitioning back to fast stuff. And so I can shoot that fast first array, and get that hit on that harder shot. And then when I transition back to paper or the closer targets, I'm shooting them at that slow cadence still. Mm-hmm. So I've got to run all these drills that mix all those things up so that I can shoot target individually based on what's necessary to execute a good shot on it, right? Even if it's in the middle of a bunch of things that use different skills. Mm-hmm. But visually and on that trigger press, What are some of the hardest things to do?
Do you ever pick a cadence in your head in practice and try to match that to sort of switch gears?
I've tried doing that on distance when I feel like I should be shooting something further away faster, but I'm not seeing what I need to see in order to shoot it faster. And so I'm like, okay, here's the cadence. Here's what I have to do. I'll figure out how to get hits that way. And I've played around with that. For me, that's been mostly on carbine stuff where I'm going, okay, like this should be an aim once, shoot twice target. That's the way I look at a lot of stuff with the long gun. It's either an aim twice or an aim once target, depending on difficulty level as it relates to carbine. You just manage recoil so much better. So I'll get stuff in that like 50 to 60 yards range on PCC. That's a big target. It's like that is right on the edge of an aim once target, and it's like I got to get it. Like I got to figure it out. So I'll bring steel. I'll mess with that. Yep. I'll mess with being able to just hammer. And what does it take? And now what does it take if I came into position and shot that way? Like, yeah, it's really easy if I'm just stationary, but then I just start, what does it take if I take that and then I leave that position right after that? And I mess around with some of that. But usually it's on difficult stuff that I feel like it's far away and I should be shooting it faster. And based on what, I don't know. But I'm like, man, that seems like I should be able to shoot that a little bit quicker. So I'll play with that.
Well, you're basically letting the wheels fall off and then your eyes catch up eventually.
Yes. Yep.
I like to shoot the PCC for a very specific reason. I actually think it helps me kind of push the boundaries, like you're saying. Like I'll get locked into a certain like comfort level with my pistol, and then I'll just pick my PCC up and I'll shoot the stage and I'll pick my pistol back up. And what do you know? I have a better time or whatever you want to say. But do you find that helps you? It's like you kind of understand what pushing the boundaries are, kind of that Steve Anderson way of thinking, like limit a human function. You can kind of like kind of send it, for lack of better words, and just kind of see what happens. And it's comfortable. It's not so uncomfortable.
Yep. Absolutely. I believe in that principle wholeheartedly. When I start live fire in the spring, it'll be with a frame mounted open gun or a rim fire. And as fast as I can see, I can shoot because I'm only dealing with one thing. Mm-hmm. Really only dealing with, can I see that target and is the dot where it needs to be? Because the recoil piece on that frame mounted open gun or that rim fire, it's not a big deal. It's really easy to manage that recoil. And so then mixing in, making it harder with just different platforms and different guns. And I think it's a caliber carbine is a great example of that, where it's like, all right, well, I just shot it at this cadence with that gun. I should be able to do that with my pistol too. These are not difficult targets. They're not very far away. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's run it the same way. With the same cadence. And it's funny how often you can actually do that. Once you feel that cadence or you feel that speed, you do that with any number of guns. It's pretty wild.
The way I explain it to people is it's kind of like for professional swimmers, they'll put them in a pool where the water is flowing faster than they would be able to swim. So they're kind of feeling what it would feel like to swim that fast, even though they can't actually swim that fast, and it makes them faster. Mm-hmm. And they kind of catch up. Yeah. I think letting the wheels fall off, obviously that's the only way you're going to get better. You're going to learn a lot more from a miss than an alpha.
Yeah.
Yep. I'll do a lot more of that when I'm not fine tuning for an event, you know, like. Before a big event, I'm shooting alphas and I'm shooting the cadence. And that has burned me too, though. Like that has burned me as well, where I've gone, I did not push hard enough before an event. And I shot great points and my times were just off. And you know what? That sort of ties right back to training. But for the most part, I let the wheels fall off a lot in the spring and I'm developing a new skill. If I get back off of a match, I shoot so many different guns. Typically, when I come into a training camp for a gun, it's like 4 weeks, and that first week is just let them fall off, just push. I am going to miss targets today, like that's okay. And you know, that second week, I shrink the target size, and I am going to miss some targets this week. And the third week, I'm shooting alpha targets, and I am not going to miss targets, and I'm ready to shoot that match the following week. And so I've implemented some of those techniques into my normal training camps for sure, because they help me tighten things up while at the same point learning a new pace at the beginning of them.
Well, yeah, if you're 3 days out from the match, you need to be switching mentally to match mode. And if you're letting the wheels fall off, you're not going to get any better in those 3 days before you shoot your match. So it's you might as well just dial it in.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you're throwing mics in that match for sure if you're
throwing
the day before.
Sam, did you have anything else you wanted to ask?
Yeah, so we know PCC is something that you promote and you like. We see you shooting the crap at him. We see you shooting all the long guns and everything. I actually came from three gun, and one of the things that one of my three gun ex-teammates wanted me to ask is, what do you see the future in three gun and multi-gun? Do you see any future in it, is really what he was leaning towards, because it's been shrinking, especially in the Northeast, and I wish it wasn't, because I love it so much. So where do you think this multi-gun is going?
Yeah, I think you're always going to have your hardcore folks that are up for the bigger challenge, and it truly is the bigger challenge. You've got to be jack of all trades in order to execute really shoot well. So I think it truly is the ultimate action shooting sport, as far as like well balanced, wide range of skills. While at the same point, it's hard. It's hard to participate in. Meaning, if I go to a local match on a Saturday, I'm going to shoot four or five stages. I'm going to be there like 9 hours. Mm-hmm. Like you got to be all in. And so because of that. Outside of like the three gun nation fast burner stuff that they were doing, doing some of that to bring folks in to not have 9 hours on a little match. Mm-hmm. I think there will always be the multi-gun game. There will always be that, where there'll be enthusiasts and there'll be several hundred of us that want to meet once a month and go shoot. But at the same point, I do think that if you're truly going to turn that into something that's probably as established and easy to enter into as the single gun space, you probably have to do something a little bit faster pace, a little bit less than the 5 minute reset on each stage. You know, some of that stuff crushes a new dude. They're like, I shot four times for like 6 minutes in a 9 hour day. It's like, I've got life and kids, like I should be home.
Yeah, so do you see that new, the PSCL stuff kind of answering this call? Because that's where I'm actually going to try to run some of these matches next year if I can. And that's why.
Short answer is, yeah, Max gets it. And so I like all of it, meaning I want to shoot 100 round stages too. I like that. That's fun. I like the giant, huge stage. It takes the stage win is 2 minutes. It's like, that's super fun. But yeah, I think if you're gonna get adoption and grow multi-gun, and I consider multi-gun anything you're shooting multiple guns on a single stage, it's probably in Max's format or something like that, where you got a gun you can buy at the store from a pistol perspective. Maybe it's carry optics gun, something like that. You've got an AR or some carbine that's capable of shooting anything inside of 300 yards. You are moving shooters through stages in like a USPSA cadence.
Yes.
Because you get to shoot 7 or 8 times in a day then.
Yep.
And you're moving through, and it's maybe a little bit lower cost of entry.
Yes.
I think to get the masses, that's the deal. So you could have, $2,000 or $3,000 on gear. You could come play at a high level, game like that, which... I think that is what it takes in order to bring more shooters to multi-gun.
Yep.
While at the same point, there's always going to be 1,500 or 3,000 of us in the country that are going to show up and want to shoot the big outlaw stuff.
Yeah,
I don't think that goes.
It's still a good time to throw shotguns in buckets. I don't care what anybody says.
I love it. Yes.
Sam, do you have any sponsors you'd like to chime in on?
Well, I'm definitely going to shout out Modern Material for, I've been running my PCC hard lately, and that thing has been absolutely chugging along with a Vortex sitting on top of it. And I know my man here is a Vortex lover as well.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You have anyone, Josh?
This is that time of year where I am super grateful, right? So like I would just wrapped up another, what would be like my ninth year shooting. I'd call it professionally. I like to make a living doing it. So it's this is what I do, right? I shoot guns and I'm in the industry. And so I'm blessed to have a bunch of great partners that help me do what I do. And so yeah, absolutely. You know, like I work with a bunch of great brands and I try to add as much value for a bunch of great brands as possible so that we can continue to do what we do. But I'd say all of them are important. All the gun companies that support all of us are, I'd say we should all have a ton of gratitude and support those fine folks.
That's always a simple answer is people ask me like, hey, what should I buy? I was like, well, let me go through my last matchbook and see. There's your answer.
That's right. That's very much the case. Cause you know, the fact is outside, it's very hard to track. Like where this, I mean, I've got a business. I started to sponsor some matches this year and do some of that stuff. Like I've got no way to track if that's successful. So it's like Goodwill, here you go. Like hopefully this delivers some value, unless the event is doing some, you know, media and some of those things that are deliverables and they can give back, which I've been part of on the other end, trying to do that so that event sponsors start to feel like they're actually getting a deliverable for the dollar too. But yeah, it's real tough. And so the more we can, as the shooting population, support those companies that are doing things like that, the better.
All right. Well, thank you so much for coming on and sharing your tips and tricks with us.
Yeah, appreciate it.
I was happy to chat shooting. I mean, it's fun. Right? Like this is, we're gun nerds, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And I loved hearing about all your hunting stuff that you do. Cause I mean, you're basically in my backyard. I see the same animal running through my yard every day. That's pretty cool that you do that.
Yeah, it's fun. And again, it stops the burnout, right? Like I shot my last match of the season a week before Halloween. And I like to say I don't train at all in the winter, which I really don't, but I tinker. This is the one time of year where it's like, I was thinking about trying that thing, whatever that widget is. Like now is the time where I won't screw up my next match because I'm trying something. I ended up playing around on the range probably a couple of days a week, but like with no focus, the focus is on hunting and trapping and that stuff. And by the time end of January comes around, I'm going to be so ready to get back out shooting guns. It's just a nice mix, you know, a totally different pace. But I still love it. So I love all of it. Makes sense.
Well, thank you so much for coming on. We love having you. Come back again sometime.
Sounds good. Good talking with you.
Yeah, thank you, buddy.
Good to meet you.
Good to meet you, too. Thanks for coming on. It was good to hear from a champion, man. Love it.